The recognisable structured silhouette of the Gladstone bag was popularised in the Victorian era by four-time Prime Minister William Gladstone. First made in Britain, it was copied by bag makers across Europe and became fashionable for wealthy travellers.
There's some history on it, which is quite interesting. You can just about see it. From what I know, Prince can't understand the rest of it.
Did we take that Russian or double Dutch?
It's Russian, apparently, and from what I've been told, he was the illegitimate son of a Tsar.
Yay!
The handwritten name on this bag's tattered strap is actually that of Prince George Yuryevsky, the illegitimate son of Tsar Alexander II, who spent much of his life in France after his father was assassinated.
If it was a normal Gladstone, you probably wouldn't bother at this state. It looks terrible. But it does have an awful lot right with it. It has Russian royal history. What's worth more, the bag or the history? The history, of course. What can you do with that? Because that's going to snap. You've always got the danger of somebody else just picking it up and that coming off and being lost forever. And then there's no history.
It's obviously, it's an integral part of the provenance. Leave it with me. I'll do something so it's preserved.
OK. So when it's finished, where will it sit?
It'll stand up like that, but a lot taller.
Even with the old leather?
Yeah, because all the old leather's going to be resupported inside anyway. Okay. You won't see it, but all the sides, the end panels, are going to be resupported.
Tell you what, shall I just leave you to it?
It'd be a lot easier.
Yeah. Let's do that.
It'd be a lot easier.
All right, Macy.
Be careful.
Thank you.
First things first, we're going to have to dismantle it, take it to pieces, and then see what we've got. Take the locks off, undo all the stitching, lay it flat out on the bench. And if we can do that today, I'll be chuffed with that. Get the knife in and carefully go along. And you can hear it and see it cutting each individual stitch. Yeah, like that. And I think, well, it goes under there. So I think what I'm going to have to do now is stop this and take this lock off. There we go.
As the frame comes away,
there you go.
Martin can separate the outer case from its leather lining.
This is the reinforcement. Everything's just deteriorated, so all this is what we've got to rebuild. To find a piece of cardboard which is exactly the right thickness with the right rigidity, you'd never guess what I have to use sometimes, cold face boxes. And it's exactly the right temper, the right support, the right thickness.
Tucked away in the lining, Martin stumbles on a hidden trace of this bag's maker.
Oh, now have a look at there. That's the first time it's seen light of day in 100 years. Oh, two wrist. Now I wonder if let me have a look inside. Ah, now if we turn it over and have a look at the writing on the inside, is Or Tourist Monte Carlo.
Or Tourist was a Parisian maker of luggage, and their premises in Avenue de l'Opera may well have been where Prince Yuryevsky bought this Monte Carlo model to accompany him on his European travels.
This is a feed that I make myself. It's part lanolin, glycerin, beeswax. It's full of rejuvenating goodness. I'm gonna have to start doing this and let it dry and then see what it turns out like. So I've got to play softly, softly all the way along it. And I know that this could be somebody's Chad Trez's heirloom. And if I ruin it, I can't produce a new one. Little and often is the key. It'll get me up early in the morning to put another coat on, and then another one at lunchtime, and then another one at 10 o'clock. And that's the way I'll do it. How? It's not straightforward. When this was made, it was made inside out. And all the stitching would have been put in by machine. But this leather now is so fragile, and it's actually falling apart. The more manhandling it gets, the more you're trying to restitch these seams and you're pulling it and you're pushing it about, is the more it doesn't like it and it starts to tear. And this is what I've got to deal with when we're trying to stitch all this back together. I'm trying to do this backwards because the seam is going to be inverted, so I'm going to have to work from inside as much as possible, like that. And then it's got to go back in this side. I'm going to have to make a hole through the original leather. Like that. Gosh, that's not going to be any good. I'm going to have to reinforce this inside here. This is why it takes forever, because now I've got to stop and put a piece of reinforcement in, and it just takes hours and hours and hours, and tools start flying out the window and tempers start flying. You don't want to take this on if you haven't got any patience. Patience, patience, patience. And why I dreamt of doing this job sometimes, I don't know. Ow.
A week ago, this 150-year-old bag arrived on Martin's workbench as a wreck, with seams that had burst open, a structure that had collapsed, and fragile straps that were about to split.
It was in a hell of a state when it first came in. And to be able just to build it back into what it is and rebuild that history and turn around and say, well, look, there it is, you know, look at that. It does your ego the world of good.
I see what you've done with these.
They're so degraded and the leather is so fragile that you daren't use them. They're non-functional as straps themselves. So the only way to keep this provenance of the Russian owner is literally is to stitch the straps onto the bag, and that's then they will never leave that bag again.
That's fine with me, mate, really is. When I saw what Martin had done with the decayed straps, there's nothing else you could do with them. They were literally, you just pulled them once, they'd have just snapped them, fallen to pieces, and all of the history would be gone. Now, they're saved forever, and the bag is usable again. So these are new.
Yeah.
I defy anybody to say they're not the originals now.
Push. There we go.
Wow.
The original leather lining.
So this is all new card in here, isn't
it? All this, you will never guess what it's been reinforced with.
Don't tell me.
It's a popular cereal packet.
In a state of near ruin, Drew paid £150 for this bag. But Martin's restoration has taken it into a different league.
Value-wise, with the prince's name on it, do you know what? For me, it's almost impossible to say. It really is the old adage. It's what somebody is prepared to pay for it. The ideal customer is an extremely wealthy Russian, obviously. And do you know what? It will probably end up with one.